So let's dive in. Where we wanted to start is to talk about what's happening with technologies and how they're converging, and you know how that is changing the impact that we're going to see. Every major industry on the planet is about to be completely reimagined. And like I said, we're going to cover some of it today, but there's more to talk about as well. But what's driving this is this convergence of technologies, and that's what's creating this hyper-acceleration that we're seeing and why we're all talking about things are changing so fast, and we say this constantly. One of the first areas of technology where we see these kind of convergences and how it's contributing to this acceleration is in AI and ML. It's not new, but there's a higher level of interaction now online to create deep value with AI and ML. We can now process gigabits of data and do that in real time. And you know, social media has been kind of like a school for AI, where it could be trained and helping it to make it even smarter. You know, it's only about 10 years ago that only the big companies and governments had access to AI and ML, but now much of it is open source. So, and even our phones today, our smartphones, utilize AI. So that's the first technology where we're seeing this convergence. It's going to play a role, and we'll talk in each of the industries that we're going to work through. We'll talk about how these technologies that we've chosen to focus on, how these are coming together in the different industries. The second one is around 3D and 4D printing. There are, you know, new techniques to develop items at scale now. So it's no longer just about manufacturing one item. We can do this at scale, and it's now up to 100 times faster than it's ever been before. So that provides for the ability to have customization and to produce products as needed or on demand and to manufacture in remote locations. The other great thing about 3D and 4D printing is that it creates near zero waste. So we really reduce the pollution that we've been creating with all of our manufacturing up to this point. The next technology that we'll talk about is biotech. Now, biotech uses genes, cells, and proteins. And I don't know if you know this, but something like 90X% of the cells in the human body aren't even human. Then we'll talk about the impact of that later. But you know, in biotech, we're using things like gene therapy that takes out this defective DNA and replaces it all together. We'll talk about things like CRISPR technology. You know, CRISPR allows us to repair or edit DNA while it's right in the cell. And we can even edit a single letter within a single strand of DNA now. Stem cell therapy, this you know, replaces the cell altogether. And the result is where biotech is taking us is to very customized medicine and the impact that that can have for us. Material science is another area that's really fascinating with some great things that are happening. It's really beyond what we can glean from the natural world. So we're actually creating materials. We're creating lighter and stronger materials. Things like graphene. Graphene is a million times thinner than a human hair. And if you covered a football field with it, it would weigh just about half a penny. And it's 200 times stronger than steel. Those kind of big leaps forward in material science will have big impacts on the industries that we're going to talk about. Then we have things like borophene, stronger and more flexible even than graphene. Graphene has a tendency to break. So we've blended it with concrete at times to also enable conducting electricity. So it's just amazing some of the things that we can do with these materials and how that's having such an impact. Even things like shape-shifting materials, like liquid metal. We can program something to be a hammer, and then later we can reprogram it to be a screwdriver. And last but not least, we have AR and VR. So augmented reality and virtual reality. You know, still in the early days to some extent of virtual reality. Some might say we're further along than others, and we can debate that. But you know, virtual reality gives us some things, but there were pieces that were missing. We didn't have a real way to interact, and now we do. We have gloves, we have suits, we even have flavor generators, so that we can stimulate the sensation of a flavor while you're in this virtual world. 100 million people are using AR-enabled shopping right now. Not right this minute, but in today's world. And you know, the biggest growth with this is in industrial. You know, the impact of being able to work in plants and manufacturing and all kinds of industrial use cases. So AR can be used for indoor navigation, you know, finding your way in a shopping mall or an office complex, or it might be a heads-up display in a car, or traffic alerts or directions or hazards. There's all kinds of ways that we see this impacting our world. And you know, we need hardware that isn't cumbersome. So there's still some things to come that will move this along and accelerate it even faster. But we do have companies that are you know, trying to reduce this down so that the hardware itself becomes almost unnoticeable to us. Maybe just becoming a part of a pair of glasses that we already have. So we're gonna talk about how these technologies converge together, where two or more of them converge, and the impact, because it's that real impact of convergence. And you know, one of the things that we want to remember is that, you know, technologies don't exist in isolation. Sometimes you can have the most advanced piece of technology ever conceived, but without the right ecosystem to support it, it's nothing but an academic experiment. So it's the fact that these are coming together and the way that they're coming together and creating the ecosystems almost simultaneously. Each of the technologies we're going to talk about is disruptive in its own right, but it's really with the convergence that will cause them to disrupt the world that we know today. In the book, The Future's Faster Than You Think, there's a quote that says, "Solitary exponentials disrupt, while convergent technologies wash away products, services, and markets, as well as the structures that support them." So we can see that the potential impact there can be very big. Where we want to focus today is the impact to security and maybe privacy, and see how we can be thinking about this as we go forward. So we want to start with Diana, who's going to talk with us about alternate worlds.
Okay, thank you so much, Lisa. Yeah, I mean, alternate worlds, and we'll start with smart cities, are actually one of the areas where you couldn't have a smart city if you didn't start seeing these technologies converge the way that they're converging. We've probably all heard the word smart city, but in the United States, our cities aren't quite as smart at this point as they are in some other parts of the world. Is anybody here from the Middle East, like Dubai or Egypt, or from ASEAN, like in the Malaysia area? Anyone from China? Okay. So what you might be surprised about is that in all of those areas, they're actually actively building smart cities right now. And that doesn't mean smartifying existing cities, which we're doing some of in the United States. And that can be a very simple smartification in terms of things like a parking deck, right? A parking deck that's got sensors in it. It can tell you if people are there already. And then before you leave home, you might be able to reserve a parking spot. Smart cities about things like smart roads, because autonomous driving is going to be much more implementable with smart roads. So we're looking at some of that in the U.S., but outside of the U.S., they're creating whole massive cities. One of the ones that's going on is NEOM, which means the future, and it's going to span from KSA, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, across to Egypt. It's going to be 33 times larger than New York City. And they're building this smart from the ground up. So they're thinking about signal, not just in isolated areas like parking meters or a parking deck, or even the lights so that your ambulance can get through, but thinking about smart from and sensor-based from the ground up. So as you build the city, the roads are smart. The roads can absorb solar, which can then charge your car as you drive over it. That looking at things like alternate energy to be able to heat and cool that system. In Malaysia, they're creating an entire forest city, for example, where they're going to grow food that's going to be eaten at the city on the roofs of the buildings that are being deployed. So there's a lot, when you can do this from the very beginning, there's a lot that you can implement. You need AI and ML to be able to actually realize this, because you need intelligence within those systems and sensors. But now think about a city manager. You know, I live in a really small town. I live in New Hampshire, and we're we're no, the Cow Hampshire is our nickname because there are more cows than people, they say. So I think about our city managers, and you know, they're dealing with this very small area. It's been around for hundreds of years, you know, not a lot of people, and it's not the most technically advanced necessarily, as a lot of smaller towns aren't. Think about a city manager in a smart town. What do they have to think about? They have to think about security. They have to think about the implications. You almost have to have a CTO or a CISO for a smart city as a city manager, because all of that wonderful censoring, what if it goes wrong? Right? What if instead of getting an early alert about water not being available so that you can bring water in or you can start to maybe seed the clouds to water your smart city, what if that doesn't work? Somebody has hacked it. What if somebody hacks the road, the autonomous road that's helping to move your autonomous cars? So we're going to be in a situation where all of this wonderful advance in smart cities, which is already being here and built in some parts of the world, will not be long-term reliable if we don't think about security and building it in. The second thing I was going to talk about in terms of the alternate worlds is nanochips. Lisa talked a little bit about healthcare, and this starts to touch on it. Nanochips are extremely small chips that can, it's a kind of journey, you know, the incredible journey in your body, that you can inject in people and actually be active to stop cancer, for example, respond to different kinds of disease. And this is not just a maybe tomorrow. This kind of nanotechnology for body change is already something that's in lab trials today. Now, remember how people felt, some people were worried that perhaps there might be some nanotechnology in the COVID vaccine, and that was the reason that they didn't want to get the COVID vaccine. There isn't, but nanotechnology is something that does exist, and some of the things people were worried about are things we do need as a community to think about as we're looking at nanotechnology, you know, in those lab trials around security. Because if you inject somebody with something that's supposed to attack cancer cells, attack leukemia, what if somebody hacked it? What if instead of attacking those cells, it happened to encourage the growth of those cells? And what if they were doing this to somebody who's very important at a company, like a CEO? You could bring down the whole company potentially, you know, by making the CEO sick. So another area where we really, the advance and the convergence of technology have really allowed us to do things in a much more exciting and interesting way, but we must think about the security. The next one is colonizing Mars and the moon and looking at space travel. Right, Jeffrey Bezos, congratulations, he did it. He got to space for 10 minutes. But that is not where, if any of you are kind of wondering, what are people gonna do in space for 10 minutes other than kind of float around and have fun. You're not alone. A lot of organizations are not looking at just like, can we just go up to space for 10 minutes? But what do we do when we're up there? And two main areas that are being built out right now, and one of them is supposed to be available in 2025, which I'm like, wait, is this 2022? That's 3 years. But it's called Voyager Station, which is a space hotel. And just like the International Space Lab rotates around the Earth, the Space Voyager Hotel, Voyager Station, like a cruise ship in the universe, is going to orbit around the globe, and it's going to allow space travelers, instead of just going up for 10 minutes coming back down, they can go hang out in this hotel. And they're also going to be creating offices. Now, again, this is planned for 2025. That feels a little ambitious, but that's where, even if they don't make that by a few years, it's still pretty close. We're still living in the future. The Jetsons are here. Another area that's really big is moon. What do we do on the moon? NASA has created inflatable habitats where we could potentially go camping on the moon. So, you know, you want to go up to the Adirondacks or you want to go to the moon. And then there are also a lot of materials in outer space, on the moon and Mars, that may be valuable, that if we can mine them, could we bring them back to Earth? There's also research going on in, could we bring things off of the Earth, things like nuclear waste that we're not sure we want to keep here on the Earth? Can we move those? So security implications, as you could imagine. I don't know, how do you guys feel about, would you go to a hotel that's orbiting the Earth in the next few years? I would not, but maybe I'm just really risk averse, but I'm not quite ready to accept that risk. But you know, as security professionals, we may have to deal with the fact that our executives want to accept that risk. And do we want to let them go up there? Think about all the different security. How about communications? How will they be talking back to Earth? Obviously, the security of, is that going to be safe to be up orbiting the Earth in the hotel? The other big thing to think about, where's the legal governance of space? We know that there's maritime law, and when you get out into the middle of the ocean, it's different than the laws that you have, right? You can gamble out at a certain distance from shore. You can start gambling because laws are different. What about Earth? You know, what about outside of Earth? What if you're in space? What if there's a discussion between a CEO and a CFO that occurs in space that's overheard and somebody shorts the stock? Is that illegal? Is it going to be governed by the same laws that we have governing here on Earth? So thinking about that also with, you know, if one country tries to, and right now there's an agreement that no country could colonize the moon, for example, no country can colonize Mars specifically, but we don't know in the future how that's going to hold up, and if there becomes a really important material that's out in the universe, out on one of these planets that we need, governing that could be a big security concern too. And then the last area is one that we know is already here in a lot of ways. How many people already have an AR or VR deck, like a holodeck or anything like that, that you go into the alternate, the metaverse already? Anybody already doing? So I was in Second Life for a while, but I didn't know really how to work that. But that was one of the early metaverses. So Second Self. And having a second world or universe to live in, there right now the metaverse is being looked at as where we're going to live our lives. We're going to have meetings there, and we're going to go to conferences there. We're going to have, and we went to this conference last year virtually, and it was pretty much video conference. But what about having our avatars? And then as we start thinking about security implications, one convergence area that I think is really interesting is, as AI has gotten better at emulating people, could we just send like an AI bot to a meeting that we don't want to go to? Everybody would think we're there, right? And if there's not a lot of conversation with the bot, it could potentially pass as you. There is something else that's a big concern, which is the Proteus effect. And the Proteus effect is, it's emerging research, but it's pretty clear cut that when somebody does something to our avatars, it feels like they did it to us. So if you have an avatar in Minecraft or in one of these alternate universes, and you're having a conversation and somebody starts saying something really mean to that avatar, you don't think, oh, well, they're just saying that to my avatar, that's not me. You feel it as though they've insulted you. And there have been some incidents of bullying and attacking already in different alternate universe and metaverse. So that's a concern. What if you create a space and people come in, but they start bullying? So now you might have to, your company may say, we want to have an online store. And that's great, we got the real estate, we want to have people come and engage with us, but what if then that online store, they get bullied? So now do you have to be the police for what's going on in your online universe? And being concerned about if you're dealing with the people you think you are, because we could have even more misuse of avatars than we already have on the internet, which people have already taken pretty much advantage of the fact that on the internet no one knows you were a dog initially. And the last point that I'll make before, because Theresia has a great space to go here from this, is what goes on financially in the metaverse, especially if we're going to be using crypto or other non-fiat government currency. There have already been big cases of money laundering through the online gaming worlds. But if we start transferring more and more of what we do professionally and commercially into these universes, and we start using less fiat currency and more of the cryptocurrency and the DeFi, the decentralized finance world, does seem to be moving more and more into the metaverse, that also can have some pretty significant security considerations. So with that, I'll hand it over to Theresia.
Do we have your mic on? We may need a sound check.
Oh, there we go. Awesome, thank you.
Fantastic.
Thanks, Diana. So you brought a couple of great things which are related to what I'm going to talk about, which is around Web 3. The first one is, it's funny that you mentioned Second Life and then the lab, because for those of you who have lived, so one, I was actually an early investor in the
I couldn't use it.
Well, you and a lot of other people. But for those of you, the original, the reason why it was called Linden Labs, which is the parent company of Second Life, because it was on Linden Street, about seven or eight blocks away from here. So for those of you interested in that. But talk about convergence. I think the metaverse and the virtual world today, which is a part of Web 3, and I've also spent quite a bit of time talking about what Diana started talking about, which is decentralized finance and what this potentially impact there. Is number one, back then, and this used to be pretty industrial, because they actually had to have humans rigged with sensors in order to create the 3D animated character, the avatars, right? Now, there is far more specific, hardware is not more specialized, hardware for inputs are needed, the software is so much more robust in terms of the gaming engines and the 3D rendering engines, and frankly, the compute power in your cool little phone is higher than what was frankly available in most not gamer laptops, but most regular work-oriented type PCs or laptops. So I think that's a perfect example of convergence where the technology has enabled much richer 3D worlds. And the other problem, which is sort of still a problem, but and this is where the machine learning and AI come in really, is there's still the empty room phenomenon. But now with machine learning and artificial intelligence, like I actually just looked at two companies last week that were using natural language processing to create real life sounding voices for characters that could be avatars in like probably not like in AAA type games, but in sort of the newer metaverse type games where part of it is you're supposed to be at a concert, or you're supposed to be in a movie, like you're supposed to be in a large, or maybe you're supposed to be at a conference, right? Yeah. And they don't want the empty room problem, right? So there are the real people who, like Diana or Patty or Lisa, who come with their avatars and then they can auto-generate other avatars and speak and interact with you in a normal fashion. So pretty cool, pretty far out there stuff, which doesn't require any special hardware or software. I'm like, okay, poor Bill Rosedale, the early Linden Labs days. But from a security concern perspective, right, you started to touch on it, right? It's like, okay, people are, and this is the part of the whole challenge at the application layer with Web3, right, is how do we authenticate identity, whether that's Diane's actual identity or Diane's avatar, when the whole premise of Web3 is there's no centralized entity for anything. Right, so it's all embedded. If it's either something in the smart contract that validates, and the blockchain itself does the work as proof of work to verify it's Diana. But so then, from a security perspective, think about how, like, so then what if someone actually did steal your identity in a memory? Who would you talk to? How would you go about like reclaiming your identity? And I know this sounds like not necessary. It's sort of funny until it happens to you, right?
Right.
So if you're a serious gamer, like one of my kids, that would be really problematic. And it's even problematic now in centralized platforms, like, you know, at least now it's like, it might take a long time for someone to get back to you, but you can flag it to somebody at Roblox or at Meta if this has happened to you. as you pointed out. So those are some of the interesting things that I think there's a lot of, it's very early days, but I think just like with Web 1, which was sort of, you know, the late 90s, first HTTP, and with Web 2, which I would think of as like mobile web, and then 2.5 is like sort of cloud. Now with what I think of as Web 3, which is thinking about blockchain, we've been talking at the application layer, but we're talking about blockchain as sort of infrastructure, as a comms layer, where computers communicate with one another. Every time there's that type of platform shift, a whole new set of security concerns always comes to play, and a whole new set of security solutions need to be created each time. And I think we're at the cusp of that. And lest we think that it's super early innings, and I totally agree that, you know, certainly NFTs and decentralized finance and maybe even ownership of things outside of maybe BTC and ETH are certainly not mainstream, although I found that they're increasingly mainstream with my Gen Z partners. So point number one for your Gen Z employees, they I will tell you that this is already something we need to think about, and I'll tell you why. So specifically on decentralized finance. So getting to $4 trillion of transactions is a big deal. I think most people would agree that's pretty reasonable transaction volume. It took credit cards 15 years to achieve $4 trillion in transactions. It took cryptocurrencies 10 years. So it's already happened. Again, maybe not for mainstream, but for, I guarantee you, for some people in your organization. My Gen Zers prefer to invest in cryptocurrency than in individual stocks when they take off their retirement.
Yeah.
Anyway, there. Well, just like, I don't know what's happening in the drop football now either. So nobody's very happy right now, no matter what you invest in, since January 1st. So it's already at a significant scale, and as I said, the challenge with decentralized finance is that in addition to the fact that, so if you think about continuing the credit card analogy, so 1.0 version of credit card, right, Visa, MasterCard credit card networks, obviously there still is fraud, there are tons of risks, but you're dealing with professional entities that are known and highly regulated, and that's on all ends, not just the networks, but the banks who are issuing the cards, the merchant banks that are receiving the credit cards, and so on, right? Okay, Web 2, you get P2P payments, Venmo, PayPal before that, and that seems like, and it is, a much more challenging problem because now you've got these endpoints, people just exchanging value with one another, but yet, at least you still have centralized entities which ended up being pretty regulated themselves, right? Now, truly decentralized finance means not just person to person, but machine to machine, with smart contract and rules embedded in either your DeFi, we'll just stick with that. And again, no one to be a centralized clearinghouse for that information. There's no way to really undo a transaction once it's happened. I'm not sure who you would try to speak to. It's an immutable
blockchain.
All, right?
Yes.
Now, there's in theory, there's other positives, right? Because just as with person-to-person payment, because it's more distributed, there's not necessarily an easy centralized place to try to attack in order to get, you know, thousands or millions of accounts necessarily. So we got that going for us against the bad guys. But on the other hand, the level by design, the level of anonymity that is embedded, no KYC, no, I mean, this is creating significant challenges. And then I guess I was tying it back to the beginning, so again, back to one. If we think about it, right, and we talk about the fact that, of course, yes, cryptocurrency is the de facto choice of ransomware and a lot of other bad guys, but if we think back even to the early days of the internet, I always used to joke, whenever there's going to be another chain, who's going to be the first user versus, like, vice, right?
Yeah.
So, like, porn, drugs, everything
Thank you, Trace. So now we have Patty who's going to talk to us about what's happening with transportation.
So I remember when I was a little kid riding in that cool seat in the back of the station wagon, you know, the one that faced out backward, right? And you learn very quickly about your brain-eye-stomach mechanics, right? Yeah, you learn that at an early age that your body's programmed to ride forward. This is all relevant, trust me. So watching TV shows like Lost in Space and The Jetsons, I loved that one, I never would have imagined where we got to today. So when I think about how many years, when I was doing research for this, how many years it took for the combustible engine to now be challenged by electronic cars, by electric vehicles, it was years in the making. When I started to do the research, you could see that this convergence of artificial intelligence, robotics, nanotechnology, biotechnology, material science, a lot of the things Lisa talked about, and then add to that networks and sensors. And those all are fueling the acceleration in the development of capabilities that would have taken years before. This convergence now allows things to happen in hours versus 20 or 30 years. It took 20 years to get a radio in a vehicle, if you can think about that. We get in our car and we're streaming and humming Katy Perry down the road. Well, I am. I don't know about the rest of you, but pretty sure I sound like her. But that means that we're going to be, as humans, traveling at warp speed. So it kind of gets back to the brain-eye-stomach theory. How is that all going to work? I think maybe nanotechnology might help with that. Maybe it'll wrap some sensor around our brain not to be quite so upset. So it all sounds kind of cool. So like the concept of flying cars, the DeLorean, Back to the Future, we all remember that, right? We weren't, of course, when I was watching that, I wasn't like thinking about, what happens when Marty goes back in the future, or when he goes back in time, or he goes forward in time? What are the privacy implications? You know, does he have a right to drive a car back then? I don't know. But when you analyze the capabilities that are already here, so when I did the research, I was absolutely floored that all that needed to happen was Elon Musk got mad. And what that meant is now we have autonomous vehicles for people to get in. The idea of giving up my privacy data. So think about, here you are, not to mention the physical effects of warp speed or near warp speed daily, but think about the implications of converging and giving all of your personal data, like my calendar, to a rideshare app, just so that that autonomous vehicle will show up at my door at the prescribed time. And then it's going to drive me to the nearest place where I can get on in an unmanned vehicle to take a short helicopter ride, basically, from Richmond, Virginia to New York City because I have a meeting. And that's going to happen in about 15 minutes, from the time I get on the vehicle in Richmond to the time I get off in New York. And the autonomous vehicle knows exactly where to drop me to the closest point so that I can get to my meeting the quickest possible way. So there's innovation around vetting a lot of pieces here. So I worked at TSA a long time ago when we first stood up. Well, it wasn't really that long ago. It was in 2000. And there was a new technology that came out that was used and is used in several airports called At a Glance. And it was a way so that you could be like Global Entry, TSA Pre, all those perks that you get. The At a Glance technology was a biometric capability of looking at your retina, doing a scan, and then vetting you through. The gates would automatically open. You looked up, through you went. Imagine going to this autonomous vehicle place, this unmanned vehicle. You're going to get on it. You got to be vetted, right? So who's going to do that vetting process? Now I've given up probably a lot more biographical data about myself so that I can be properly vetted to be able to get onto the vehicle. So that's more of my privacy data that I've given up. So there has to be innovation. There has to be governance around it. There has to be some way to be sure that threat actors aren't taking control of your identity at the biographical data level, let alone the fact that they steal credit cards and driver's license and social securities. Now they're going to take my biographical data. Now when I go and say, that's really not me, the proof of that gets even harder. Now imagine that, you know, think about Die Hard. Remember the movie Die Hard where the guy takes control of the city and he changes the lights and thank goodness for Bruce Willis. But you know, at the end of the day, imagine that you have an insider threat of a disgruntled employee who's doing all that biographical checking of the flying cars, and he changes the chipset, let's say, in a controller. Somebody's gonna ground a bunch of flying cars. How are you gonna get to work? Talk about disaster recovery at a catastrophic level. Imagine, oh, I'm sorry, I can't get to work today because my air ride's down. Or the sensor company has a flaw in the chipset. You got supply chain issues that have come into play. And then, you know, there was this, well, let's go back for a minute. Let's go back for a minute back to my meeting. I've gotten onto my autonomous vehicle, and all the while I'm sitting in the meeting, my virtual assistant, my avatar, has been taking notes using voice-to-text translation, has already assigned out all the tasks, probably using my really cool Microsoft tools, and given tasks to all my team. There's a few of them sitting in the room. And they have, before I even get in my vehicle to get back to my office at home, of course it's going to be hybrid, everything's already been assigned so that I can go about the rest of my day. So the other thing that was interesting when I was doing the research is I had heard about it kind of maybe, but the Hyperloop concept, where the Hyperloop is being, I mean, it's taking your, moving you at like hundreds of miles an hour from point A to point B. I know that there's infrastructure being built already in India. I think things got set back a little bit based on COVID, that some infrastructure plans have changed as far as delivery dates, but these are like 2027, they're supposed to be delivered, that you'll be able to move from two different cities, and I'm drawing a blank on them, sorry.
Chicago and DC, maybe?
There's a Chicago, DC, and there's a Mumbai, there's another one in India that's being built. And the Hyperloop concept is to get you faster from point A to point B. I'm still voting for the flying car. I would say that right at this particular point, as security professionals, we can wait to be called to the table, or we can ask to push in so that we can get into the front of these types of technologies. Because I'm pretty sure while we're looking at cool technologies, as with many things, we get called to the table last. And so this, I think, is an opportunity. We're getting the high sign over here for 10 minutes, so let me just be very quick and wrap up. So the rapid development and prototyping in the future of transportation is also going to be probably plagued with the rapid innovation on the hacking side. The threat actors will be right alongside of us, and we've got to develop solutions that will solve for these future needs that are here actually today. We need more development in quantum encryption, sensor wrapping technology, things that make it impenetrable. And then we need governance beyond our wildest dreams of governance, but not the kind that derails everything, but the kind that allows freedom within the framework. We need less regulation or none of it's gonna happen. I hate to say that. So today's tomorrow is already here, and I'll turn it over to Lisa.
So we'll talk really quick about health, and then we'll have some time for questions. I'll go through this, you know, kind of quick. We won't necessarily go into each and every one. But some of the things that are coming along in healthcare, they're exciting. They're gonna do some wonderful things for us and hopefully move us from really what's been sick care to actual healthcare. Because, you know, it's up till now it's been, we don't really get help with medical issues until we're sick. And by then, sometimes the cure takes much longer than it should have. But the converging technologies around healthcare will be things like AI and ML, biotech and material science. And especially with material science, you know, it brings some really interesting things that we can do. And so not just things like electric bandages, so that you can wear a bandage that's actually stimulating recovery of whether it's a, you know, a skin issue, you have a cut, or whether it's a muscle, but you know, that's exciting enough. But you know, we also have things that are coming together to you know, self-repair. And so we can use things like nanobots or nanoparticles to create self-repair. Whether you're, you know, you're going in for a colonoscopy, and you know, it won't just be, hey, we found something and we took it and we're gonna send it off, and in a couple of weeks we're gonna tell you that's something really serious. It's gonna be that while they're in there, they've taken care of everything. The nanobot has taken care of that for you, and you're done, and you know, see you next year or in 5 years. So there's some really exciting things that are happening in terms of the self-repair capability. There's tooling coming into play in terms of being able to sniff diseases. We actually have technology today that's being prototyped in several hospitals that has the ability to detect up to 20 common types of diseases just from sniffing, from, you know, smelling, and you know, the potential odors that we give off when we have a disease. And so it's able to detect those today. It's being prototyped and tested. We also have technology that is then coming from that that will be able to, we'll wear a sensor. So it might be a nano sensor that we're wearing that will tell us, oh, by the way, it looks like you have some precancerous cells that are forming. So different types of diseases that we'll pick up that way. Other things that'll come out of this in terms of exciting is regenerative medical devices or programs or tooling, and you know, the ability to not necessarily prolong our life, but to give us a much higher quality of life, so that you know, they can take stem cells to, or they can take cells today to create stem cells. So we can now create that without a baby, which is where stem cells really come from. And we can create these cells that not only do we go all the way back to stem, but we could kind of stop in the middle somewhere. So we've created a much healthier, a much younger cell, and we could potentially replace the cells in our body so that at the age of 65, I actually feel like I'm 30. So there, you know, just some really exciting changes that are coming along that way. Then we have things like being able to download what's happening in our brain, you know, to download our memory and store our memory externally. So if we think about the risks that come out of this, you know, the security implications and the things that can happen, you know, I like to use an approach in terms of, I call it dials PS. And so the D for data, you know, thinking about DNA as data and what the implications of that may be for us going forward. Is that a possible target for attackers? I for insider risks, you know, thinking things like, you know, could someone actually cause me to swallow a nanoparticle that could create a disease in me or could send signals to them later? And that could be very easy. The size of a nanoparticle, I wouldn't even know that I breathed it in. So potential insider risk from that. Automation for the A. So, you know, could poor change management be deadly in healthcare? You know, the implications are really serious. Leakage, you know, are there things that we're going to be leaking? You know, does access to potentially a used electric bandage, does that give away some kind of knowledge about my life or my health? There's supply chain risks, there are physical risks, and then there are scale issues as well. You know, if you think about the downloading of memory, does that become a risk? You know, is that something that's a market risk for your company if people have external memory sitting around that came out of their brain? So there's a lot for us to consider there in terms of, you know, the potential flaws. We do have, I'm gonna skip to questions really quick, so we'll skip that quick wrap up, but we do have a tool at the very end of the session deck, so that this is just an approach. It's not ours, it's something that that we found that's an approach for, you know, just considering new technologies and the potentially new risks that come from those and assessing your ability to deal with that and your company's preparedness for that. And so this may be something that you want to take a look at. And with that, I want to make sure that we have at least a couple minutes for questions. So if you do have questions, please come up to the mics and you can address it to any one of us or just to the open group if you like. I know we kind of skipped to the end really quick, but I wanted to make sure that we had some time to ask questions.
No hecklers?
All right, I'll ask one.
Please do.
Yes.
Thank you.
In your comment about autonomous cars, you said that it's necessary to vet the passenger rules. I'm kind of confused by that because in an autonomous car, I have very little control. I'm not driving it. There's probably nobody else in it. So why does it need to vet me? It feels to me like anonymity would be great for as far as satisfactory with that.
That's a good point, but what if I'm wearing a bomb? What if I get in the vehicle? I'm thinking how many people are in the vehicle with you. So if it's like a bus, right, then yeah, it's if it's just you in the vehicle, I don't think it's a problem other than destroying property and just being annoying. But yeah, so I'm thinking like you're getting onto more like a shuttle that's unmanned, that's driving a group of people, and it's going to. Have you ever been in the elevators? Like, we have this in our London office, and it drives me crazy, where you push, you swipe, and it says you can go to these floors, go to elevator A or B or M, and you're like, "What? Where am I going?" Right? And you're not really paying attention. So imagine that on steroids, where it's going to tell you what platform to go to so that you can, before you even get there, so that you can go.
All right.
I mean, so I'm thinking bus. Yeah, if I'm by myself, you're right.
And actually, in all the smart cities that are being built right now, one of the cores is having public transportation that's totally autonomous. So,
yeah.
It's already here.
Yep.
Your biographical data. Other questions?
So ladies, I'll ask you a question. We've talked about a lot of different types of technologies, a lot of different types of risks. What was the one that either surprised you or concerned you the most? Deeply personal.
Your actual current mental state, can you say.
And how much would we be willing to give up based on convenience?
Yep.
I mean, smart technology that's sitting in our pockets, you're giving up a small amount. Imagine giving up a significant amount.
Yeah, everybody was worried about being tracked with a nanotechnology from a vaccine. It's like, we are tracked. You know, we pay a lot of money to be tracked.
Ooh, we got the big stop sign. That's the first time I've seen a green stop sign, though.
Well, thank you so much
for
coming.
Thank you all.
We appreciate it.
Thank you.